Good afternoon, everyone, or good morning if you're out on the West Coast. My name is Matt Umbro, and today Garrett Mergut and I are going to be going over how to dominate SEO and PPC listings with 5 tactics. My name is Matt Umbro. I'm a senior account manager here at Hennepin Marketing, and I also blog for PPC Hero. And joining me today will be Garrett Mergut. He's the CEO of Directive Consulting. Hey, Garrett, how are you?
I'm doing well, Matt. Thanks for having me today. I'm excited to be here.
Excellent. Well, we're excited to have you. And, you know, coming from where we solely do paid search here and PPC here at Hennepin, it's going to be fun to talk about how SEO can help PPC and vice versa.
Oh, yeah. No, it's going to be – I think there's a lot of valuable information. And when you combine the two, it's really powerful. So I think it's going to be great.
Excellent. So – if you want to join in on the conversation, you can just go to Twitter and tag your tweets with a hashtag ThinkPPC, or you can use the webinar question box to send us questions. During the presentation, Garrett and I will be answering questions, and then we have the question, and then at the end there will be time for a live Q&A. So again, either use the question box or reach out to us on Twitter with the hashtag ThinkPPC. So let's get started with a poll question for the audience. And we're asking here, how long have you been in PPC? Maybe a year, 1 to 3 years, 3 to 5, 5 plus. How long have you been there? And Garrett, what about you? How long have you, I know you're primarily SEO, but how long have you been working on PPC as well?
Yeah, it's been about almost 3 years. I think we're hitting our 3-year anniversary in February, so it's super exciting. You know, we started doing a lot of really just PPC pure focus almost 2 years ago, I'd say. So probably like in that 2-year range, we started off definitely just SEO. And then we realized how much power was in it if we could actually combine the SEO with the PPC, get the data on the pay-per-click side to then build out better content campaigns, build out better on-page targeting, better title tags. And yeah, I know it's been a awesome journey. I feel like there's still so much more to be learned on all of it. So I'm just glad I get to be here learning with everyone else.
Yeah, no, absolutely. PPC is one of those things that, you know, it's been around for a while, but, you know, it just kind of ties in with all other channels and vice versa. So looking at the poll answers, it looks like the majority of you have either been in PPC for 5 plus years or 1 to 3 years, and then we have about a quarter of you have been there less than a year. So this is good. We have a good mix of the audience as we go through these questions. Or I'm sorry, as we go through these tips. So having said that, let's move to our first tactic to dominate PPC and SEO. And we're going to begin here from learnings you can gain from the PPC side to help with organic. So the big thing here, especially since Google moved to expanded text ads with the double headlines, is that these PPC double headlines, and when you include the hyphen between the headlines, can be up to 63 characters. And then that, which is interesting because the organic page titles generally show up to 65 characters. So in essence, your AdWords headlines look almost identical now to your organic page headlines or the organic page titles. And really the takeaway here is that you can test headlines with PPC and use them in your organic page titles. So as an example, you know, here are two ads we have that both use the same headline one but have a different headline two. So the first ad speaks to more of the inventory with the beans, broccoli, garlic, whereas the second ad speaks more of a value proposition, your satisfaction guaranteed. And you're already testing your headlines out in paid search, so don't only use that data from the PPC side, but bring it into your organic efforts as well. So having said that, you can look at your performance, and we see that our inventory type ads actually have a better cost per conversion and higher conversion rate with the significantly higher CTR. So that headline may be something we want to try on our organic for SEO on that page's title. Maybe we say something like, you know, here's our brand and here's what we offer. Obviously, you can't A/B test on pages with organic because only one organic title shows at a time. But maybe something where you try 2 weeks with one headline and then 2 weeks with another. But nonetheless, you know, use your paid search headlines to help influence what you use in your organic headlines. So as we move on to the next tactic, let's talk about the paid and organic report available within the AdWords Dimensions tab. So I'm sure all of you out there have an AdWords, or I'm sorry, have a Google Search Console account, which was formerly called Google Webmaster Tools. So Search Console allows you to see your site how Google sees it in terms of index pages, pages with 404 errors, the schema markup, all that. So it gives you a really good insight into how Google sees your site organically. Excuse me. Just like you can with Google Analytics, you can actually link your Search Console account to AdWords and view what's known as this paid and organic report. And here's an example of that paid and organic report and how it shows in Google. Basically, you can see what happens when only your ad shows, when only an organic listing shows, and then when both show. So, you know, oftentimes we get clients that ask questions like, you know, why do I want to bid on this particular term when I'm ranking well organically for it? You see that a lot with branded terms or terms that they're ranking highly for organically. This report kind of gives you a sense of how those terms do together. Or alone. And even though you can't see conversions, you can actually see the click-through rate for paid search and then the queries, the number of queries and clicks in organic and the clicks per query, essentially similar to click-through rate, but just showing how many people click for those particular queries. And you can see the average positions for both. So when we're looking at this report, we have a few main takeaways. And you know, these are just notes that we found. You know, they're not necessarily absolute, but you can use them to begin formulating a discussion of how paid and organic can work better together. The first note here is that we saw the term Puma Drift Cat. It saw more organic clicks and queries than paid search, but then again, the average position was about 20.2 compared to 3.5 for paid. So there was quite a difference there. Similarly, we saw Puma sneakers only having a paid search presence where there was one instance where Puma shoes store near me had shown a paid and organic listing at the same time. So we have those takeaways, and then as we move on, we can see what some of the subsequent action items might be. So for Puma Drift Cat, where it was only seeing organic traffic, we may want to bid higher on this keyword or add the query to our account in Google, because we know we're seeing some traffic from it organically. Let's see how it does from the paid side. And one of the items with paid search is, or and paid and organic is, the more listings you can get on a page, one, it helps your chances of improving the click to your site, because it gives you that many more opportunities for users to see your brand. But also it helps add credibility. You know, if a user sees three or four listings between, three listings on organic and one in paid, it's going to help improve the visibility of your brand and the credibility because they see more of you. The next item, if we saw more paid traffic for Puma sneakers, we may consider optimizing a particular page for this query. We know it works well in paid search. Let's see how it does in organic. Again, similarly to how we would do the organic page title based upon the paid search headlines. And then finally, with that Puma shoe store near me, seeing both organic and paid traffic, we would want to continue to optimize for this query if we saw that we were seeing conversions from the paid search side. It's something that we know is working on. It's getting traffic and it's getting listed both in paid and organic, so let's keep working with it. So far we've gone, you know, through the first couple of steps here, and Garrett, you know, before we move on to the next item here, I just want to get your thoughts and what you feel about these two tactics so far.
Yeah, I mean, I think on this one especially, The logic has to go along the lines that oftentimes we cannot control the amount of people searching for a keyword. And so I think the key here is to understand which keywords are generating the most revenue and or the lowest cost per acquisition for our business, and knowing what are the greatest opportunities. Then, once you can identify those, asking yourself, how do I take market share? So does that mean I need to launch a pay-per-click ad? So maybe I'm ranking the top three organically. We're generating a lot of revenue. We can see this under in Google Analytics under landing pages. You can then start to assume which pages are ranking well by which are generating the most clicks. You can also see this in Search Console as well. And then from there, you can say, okay, if these pages are generating the most conversions for us on the organic side, do we currently have ads here? And if we could take a launch a pay-per-click ad along those same organic queries, theoretically, you could double down and then take more market share for your most profitable keywords. And I think that's the really power here.
Absolutely. So this kind of ties into our next tactic here, excuse me, for SEO keyword research. Google, specifically with AdWords, and you know, especially compared to organic, really shows you a lot of data compared to of your queries. You can run search query reports to see the queries that triggered specific keywords to show. What this does, it allows you to find these potential organic keywords you can use on your site. And here's an example here with data straight from Google, where we see these five search terms, and we see that CTR, conversions, and conversion rate are all pretty good. We may determine that a term like garlic bulb, since it has a significant amount of clicks, and it has nearly a 14% conversion rate, we may determine that that might be a good term to optimize for SEO. So if we have a garlic bulbs page on the site, perhaps in the headline, in the organic title, we list something like garlic bulbs for sale, buy now, something like that. You can see that what we'll do is we'll subsequently map that keyword to the specific page. If we don't have a page like that, maybe we just have a garlic seeds page, but our data dictates that we could also utilize a garlic bulbs page, and because people we know are searching for that and converting. So maybe we potentially create a new landing page for garlic bulbs. And then from the organic perspective, we want to do the common practices of making sure that, again, it's in the page title, we're using the term within the content, we're using appropriate anchor text. And if we get links back to the site, if someone's linking to us for garlic bulbs from, say, a gardening site, we want them to go to that garden bulbs page, or garlic bulbs page. So again, it's about using the data you see in PPC and the query data especially to help influence what keywords you can utilize within your organic program.
Yeah, Matt, if you go back a slide too, I have an idea that might be able to help people even maximize this tactic even more that we've been playing with. So we rank in the top five for PPC agency despite not having the strongest site in the world yet. Like, we don't have the greatest domain authority. And I think a lot of sites out there might not be there yet with where they might not have that brand reputation yet. They might not have all the PR they're aiming for. They're working hard to get it, but they might not be there yet. And so a lot of what you can do on this that actually can get you there without having to spend a lot more cash or even do a lot of other changes is improve the click-through rate on your organic titles. Just like I'd say the paid algorithm is using CTR as an indication of which ads are most desirable to a user, organic is doing the same thing. And so they'll be plotting your positions within the top 10 and saying, okay, you rank number 8. Statistically, compared to other results that also rank number 8, what is your click-through rate? And if on average you have a higher click-through rate than other positions in similar queries within their data set, then they're going to say, wow, this result is more valuable to searchers. And if people aren't pogo sticking, meaning clicking on your result, going to your page, and then back-clicking back to Google to find a better result, so if you're not only earning the click for the click-through rate, but then earning their business and having them click deeper into your site, Google is going to say, wow, that's a very valuable result. So what you could do from this is you would take the data and say, okay, we have a really great conversion rate, let's say, on garlic plants, right? So you could say buy garlic plants, bulbs, and seeds. And then, instead of, so the problem is we would usually then go - brand name. It's a very very traditional way of doing SEO is you take your keywords, you would go buy three seed keywords, so you'd have bulbs, plants, and seeds. But then what you would do is brand name. And unfortunately, I think that's a mistake. Unless you are a very, very, very strong brand that inherently when people see that, they want to do business with you, and most of us frankly aren't there. What I'd recommend to do instead was illuminate some of the value that the user will receive once they land on that page. So what I mean by that is you could go buy garlic, bulbs, plants, and seeds, parentheses, 55 plus 5-star reviews, parentheses, free shipping for orders over $25. Those are types of value propositions that your user actually cares about, and if you can provide that value at the SERP level, the search engine results page, you're going to be far more likely to earn their click, and if you statistically show a higher click-through rate than others above and or below you, you can rise in the rankings and you can grow your site. And we've seen tremendous success in doing those types of tactics. And so I just want to add that, Matt, because I think this is a really, really strong point you made here.
Yeah, and you know, appreciate the feedback there, because that's really good too in terms of adding the value props. You're right. You know, not necessarily everyone's going to know the smaller brands, but if they see a free shipping message or reviews or a discount going on, they're more likely going to be able to click it.
Exactly, exactly. I think that's really powerful.
So, Garrett, I'll turn the floor over to you now to talk about the fourth tactic for dominating PPC and SEO.
Yeah. So, I didn't do much of an intro, everyone, but my name's Garrett. I have the blessing I get to write on blogs like Moz and WordStream and lots of other ones, Kissmetrics, Crazy Egg, etc. And it's been really fun because I get to talk about a lot of stuff that we're going to do for ourselves and for our clients, and that's really working. And one of those tools we're using is Answer the Public. Answer the Public is really just a better visualization of all the other keyword tools. And so what it's doing is it's showing the keywords within Google Suggest and then creating a knowledge graph around those that breaks down the questions or prepositions related to your primary keyword. And so you can find out how users buy your product or service, what questions they have, and what they need to know before they're willing to buy. So this can start to empower not only your title tags on the SEO level, the content on your on-page level, but also your pay-per-click ads to make sure that you are not just competing at the bottom of the funnel. Oftentimes when we launch pay-per-click campaigns, we compete at the bottom of the funnel when people are most ready to buy. But I think with the right retargeting, RLSAs, and other things in place, RLSAs, retargeting lists for search ads, you can actually start to use a RLSA to go after keywords that are higher up in the funnel and then to get your users to come back. So if you go to the next slide for me, Matt, what that means is, so let's say you're Buffer, okay, and you're or Hootsuite, and you have a social media tool. You're going to start to want to understand, okay, you know, we're doing really well on brand awareness, but we're not necessarily all in all the places we could be in the buyer journey. And so what you can see is you can see, like, what are the most popular social media tools? Now, if you don't have a single keyword ad group already dedicated to what are the most popular social media tools, then you're missing out on an opportunity to then take market share and speak highly relevant copy to someone searching that keyword. And so what I would encourage you to do is say, okay, what are my top five, top three, just for today, primary keywords? What are my most interested buyers searching today? Enter those into Answer the Public and then say, are there opportunities within that person's buyer journey that I'm missing out on? And if there are, start to build out single keyword ad groups, change up your landing pages and unbounce, and take really tight market share around these campaigns. Then the second thing you can do, which we find very, very successful and highly relevant, is you can start to build content around these queries. So let's say you don't have a pay-per-click budget, but you could start to, these are all of your next blog posts. Now, if you want to take this to the next level, what you can do is you can create, so you would have a core page, like a category page if you're an e-commerce site, or a service page if you're B2B. So we would have, let's say, SEO services. So then around SEO services, we would build a subfolder, and then within that subfolder, we would actually add these contents. So how much do SEO services cost? Is it worth buying SEO services in India? And all these questions that we know people have around that query, and then we would actually build the content into the subfolder that we're trying to rank for that primary keyword. So in other words, what Google's doing is, let's go back to the social media tools example. They're saying, this is the information people want to know around social media tools. And so if you want to rank for that query, you need to be the best answer to the question that people have. And so in theory, if Google sees that you are answering the questions the best and that relevant and authoritative sites are linking to your answers, you're going to be far more likely to rank for that primary keyword, because Google, at the end of the day, is trying to match people's queries and their intent to the best answers from websites. And if you can show that you not only have the most information but also the best answers, you're going to have a highly a larger chance of ranking. And yeah, that's that tactic. For the fifth tactic, we're going to want to use the wildcard. So using the wildcard is actually just putting the underscore, and you can use this before or after any of your primary keywords. And so what this will allow you to do is it'll give you direct access to the most searched queries within Google's Search Console, and you can do this directly in Google Search. And so if you go to the next slide, I'll show you how this is kind of powerful. So we do a lot of keyword research here. We use lots of tools. Everyone's got these great tools. We love Moz Explorer. I think it's the top tool right now. I also use SEMrush. I use SpyFu. We have all of them. But I really do think, and Longtail Pro, but I think Moz Explorer is doing it the best. Now, what I want to show you, though, is really, really crucial, right? So we know PPC agency is a big query for ourselves. Unfortunately, keyword tools do miss opportunities. And if I was only using keyword tools and not actually going into the SERP and actually doing some manual research, I would miss this. So what we do is we add an underscore after the word PPC agency. And we find very, very quickly that two of the top queries is pricing and costs. So we have no information on our site about PPC agency pricing or PPC agency costs. And so we realize that if the PPC agency keyword is very valuable to us, we also need to realize that people modify their queries to understand the answers that are most relevant to them and get the information they need. And so if I was buying this and I saw that, I'd be like, okay, I wonder how much I should be paying. It's a very logical question. And so what we do from this is for ourselves and for our clients, so we put an underscore after our primary keywords, and we try to find the data that maybe the keyword tools missed, because if they missed it for us, they probably miss it for our competitors, and these are very low-hanging fruit. So then what we will do is we'll build a piece of content called the PPC Agency Pricing and Cost, the Definitive Buyer's Guide. From there, we can launch ads, we can speak relevant. So on the pay-per-click side, we could talk about understand PPC agency pricing today, go after a lead that's maybe higher up in the funnel, have some nice lead magnets on that piece of content, make sure it loads fast, make sure we're giving them relevant information, add them to a retargeting list, and then start to grow our lead volume that way. And so there's lots of different ways you can grow your campaigns by using this wildcard to find keywords that maybe your tools are missing and to better understand how your best, most profitable searchers are modifying queries to get the information they need.
Look what we have here. We have a bonus tactic for you.
So I love this one. This is my favorite tactic right now. Across every one of our clients, pretty much, including my own business and ourselves, this works the best. It's the most profitable and drives the highest level of qualified leads or sales. So the idea here is that you can pay for rankings, and this isn't some black hat tactic. I just say that because it's catchy. The idea really here is what oftentimes we don't realize about our primary keywords is that our website is oftentimes not the best answer to a searcher's question. And if you go to the next slide, Matt, I can show them exactly what I mean by this. So if you search best marketing software, let's just take a moment to look at what Google is actually ranking for this. So the first result is Forbes. You can take GDN. You can take out Google Display Network ads on Forbes. Now, I found a trick, and this is like took me literally weeks and weeks of research. So you can do direct placements on Forbes, but you cannot do it unless you add .html at the end of a URL, despite Forbes not having .html anywhere in their URL format. So what I mean by that is you can actually create a custom ad for that result. So let's say I'm HubSpot, which I would definitely do if I were them, or if I was Marketo, or if I was someone like that. I would take that number one result, which is that Forbes site, and I would build custom ads on the horizontal side and on the vertical to rank above the fold with a custom placement ad that says, looking at all 15 softwares, choose the market leader. And then I would show reviews and maybe even a testimonial, and boom, right up above the fold for the number one keyword in maybe my industry. And then notice on the left side, you're going to see that there's a knowledge graph. It's following a rich snippet. And the reason this is so important is Capterra is you're actually paying on a cost per click model. Software Advice, I think, is cost per click. I can't remember if it's cost per click or monthly. I think it's cost per click. G2 Crowd, cost per click. G2 Crowd, again, cost per click. So you're seeing that of the top, what is this, six results, five of them you can pay to be listed at. What I think is so important here is your most valuable keywords that usually are lowest in the funnel are best, top, and reviews. But they're modified with either best, top, or reviews. So from directly from there, you can start to pay, quote unquote, to rank on these sites. And we find this to be highly successful for all of our clientele. And you can analyze this within your referral traffic in Google Analytics. And so you would just type in top marketing software, best marketing software reviews, and then you would quickly work to earn your reviews, leverage social proof to sell, and then build custom landing pages to go from each of these ad buys so you have a relevancy that's saying, okay, I clicked on Capterra, and then when I land, what do I see? And if you show them the next slide, I can give them an example of kind of what this looks like, Matt. So we're doing this for one of our clients. They're ESUB, they're a construction software company. And we did a couple things here I want to talk about because there's another little bonus tip that I think everybody will really enjoy. So we use modifiers to find their best opportunities. So best construction software, top construction software reviews. We notice that Capterra has a lot of market share here. So we are trying to rank them organically, but that might take 8 months. And they don't have 8 months to wait to increase their pipeline. But within 2 days, I can build out a campaign, launch custom landing pages, and immediately take market share and start generating sales qualified leads. Now, what we noticed in the top right corner, we did add Capterra. So by adding that, we also increased the relevancy so that they realize that they came from a Capterra site to this landing page. We built it in Unbounce. It almost functions as a pop-up. It's performing at over 13% conversion rates, which is really terrific. And it used to be at the 5% conversion rate, which we thought was good, but we tested something. And so for all the people out there doing software, I think there's a very valuable test. We published it on Crazy Egg. There's proof on this. Is oftentimes we're in love with the call to action being schedule a demo. I don't know why. It just permeates all of the software industry. The reality is nobody likes demos. I don't think anyone does. And so what we started to do instead was do free 7-minute demo video or free 5-minute demo video. Now you might be saying, okay, but what does that do at the end of my funnel? Does that decrease the sales qualification of these leads? The reality was is no, it did not, and we have end-to-end attribution on these. And the second point being is let's remember the point of all this. The point of all this is regardless of what they fill out and what the call to action is, you have an inside sales team that is following up with all these people. So the reality is if we could get more of the people you're already clicking and paying to cab click to your page to fill out your form, that's going to automatically give your SDRs and your sales team a lot more marketing qualified opportunities that they can follow up with and immediately pump your pipeline. And so the key here is to identify the top paid lists in your industry that are already ranking for your keywords. Don't pay for paid lists if you can't find keywords that they're ranking for. Also make sure that they're ranking in the top five. Then build custom landing pages. And then set up your ads also on sites on Google Display Network like that Forbes site. Use .html at the end of it to get that targeted placement. And relax. I mean, the leads will start coming in. It's really amazing to see what you can do when you take market share. And you can launch all these in a week. It's really fun.
That's a really great tip. And actually, we have a question about the fifth tactic we provided here. Okay. This comes from Jonathan. When you use an underscore in the queries, does the suggested search options pull from your user search history, or is it really pulling from general market data?
From my understanding of it, it's general market data. And this tip's been out there for a while. It's just not been talked about a lot. I don't know if you can ever escape your own search history, so it's a really good question. But what I would say is that I have cleared browsers, tried it on different caches, and done a lot of different things and had different people do it, and I have found like it to be consistent. Like whenever I do it, like if I were to click on other different results and change my query, even for that PPC agency example, I can't get away from that. What happens when I do the underscore, which wouldn't be the same if I didn't put the underscore and just did a query. So I think by adding the underscore, it pulls it from the data set, not from your personalized history. I think that's valuable because theoretically you're already getting Google Suggest if you don't add the underscore. I think the underscore is what provides you the actual general data.
Sure, sure. Makes sense. So we're going to have time for Q&A in a minute here, but we wanted to point out the offers available to you if you would like. You can select one of the following, whether it's a free search assessment from Garrett's company, Directive Consulting, or an account analysis from Hannepin if you're spending at least $15K a month, or if you like both, or, you know, no thanks, you just want to listen to the webinar and go from there. So, Gary, do you want to speak maybe just a quick brief summary of what your free search assessment provides?
Hey, thanks, Matt. That's really cool. I get to do a shameless plug. I like that.
Love the shameless plugs.
Well, what we do is really, we didn't usually advertise as a free search assessment before, but we've always done these. So if someone fills out our form, we set up an initial call where we're going to gather a lot of information. I want to learn your objectives, or some of the different members of our team will speak with you. And they're going to want to learn what your goals are, what's worked in the past, what's working today, what keywords you've targeted, what you haven't targeted, what you liked about working with an agency, what you disliked. From there, once we can understand really where you're at today, we want to build you a custom strategy for free. So essentially, we're going to audit your competitors. We're going to look at the SERPs. We're going to do a lot of stuff we talked about today and say, if I was your CMO, or if whoever's doing your proposal was your CMO, and it was their money on the line, here's what they would do. And here's the next steps. Here's the cost. It'll be a fixed rate quote, so you'll understand what your budget is. We'll try to get you your estimated ad spend. The reality is sometimes you have to start small, earn the data, and then once we have the data, we make a business case. We can go to management. We can go to whoever you're reporting to together and say, look, we spent this much money. We generated this much ROI. We only have this much search impression share today. If we were to spend more, we could get there. And so, you know, this search assessment really provides a way for us to earn your trust, show you that we're not blowing smoke, and earn your business. And yeah, it's a really exciting opportunity.
Excellent. Well, so now we're going to be moving into our live Q&A session. And as a reminder, please just type in your questions within the chat box here, and Garrett and I will answer them. So, Garrett, one follow-up question to tactic number 5. It seems like people are very intrigued by this. The question is, couldn't you use an incognito browser to get the search suggestion when you talked about that fifth tactic?
Yeah, I mean, so I haven't always found incognito go as incognito as they say. I would just... like, so there's a whole post on this, and a lot of people are talking about this today. Michael King from iPollRank put something on the Moz blog the other day talking about technical SEO and a lot of what's going on here. I don't think, so for example, when we're all using our keyword research tools and it's showing you your keyword rankings, I don't think you can get away from the fact that people are modifying, extending, and retyping their queries, and all the keyword data out there is really more of a benchmark based on fresh crawlers that have no actual data. The reality is every person out there has a whole history attached to themselves, and you can see this in countless areas. You can say, what movie is Tom Cruise a bartender in? And it will literally, without mentioning the keyword, it'll show you in a quick like result box that movie. You could search Justin Bieber, okay, and then another search right after that, say, how tall is he? And Google will actually know that that pronoun is referencing Justin Bieber and give you the information. It's insane. So I think we want to get away from the idea of, well, what is, like, is this a totally pure query, and how do I make this locally relevant? If you do want to make it locally relevant, Bright Local has a tool that allows you to search in a location, because Google did remove that SERP feature. So Bright Local has a tool you can use. But I would say the key here is to understand, okay, but what does my buyer want to know along the journey? And I think the wild card allows you to see what most people are modifying their query to. And that's where the value comes, is to understand the larger audience and then build content around that audience so that you can take more market share. Yeah, nothing's perfect right now because everything is modified by the data sets. I find that to be even true. I've seen it incognito. But yeah.
Okay. So one question that I wanted to get your opinion on from the SEO side, and I'll share kind of what I've seen from the PPC side. But earlier this year, Google removed the right sidebar ads, only showing ads above and below the organic listings, and really cutting the total number of ads, not including PLAs, the total number of text ads that could show on a page from 11 at the most to potentially 7 at the most. And my question to you is, how do you feel that has impacted your organic traffic?
Wow. Depends on the industry. So, for example, when going after other marketers, I found that they don't click on ads very much. For example, I have like launched ads on PPC agency that mimic the title tags I have for my organic side or that I'm testing things on. They're really great titles, and I can barely get them to click. I mean, I was trying to spend as much money as possible just to see if I could get them to click, and it wasn't the case. So I think it really depends on the industry you're targeting. I would say the more sophisticated the industry, the more oftentimes they go down into organic. And I would say the less sophisticated, the more time they don't know the difference. So B2C B2C pest control. Like, we have like insane, this like ridiculous click-through rate numbers on our AdWords. And then on other accounts, we can barely get them to click, despite whatever tests we're running. So I think it really depends more so on the industry than the changes, is what I've seen.
I think that's a good point. You know, what we've seen from our side is that you know, we were already essentially bidding for the most part to be in those top three positions in Google. Even before expanded text ads were rolled out, you could still do the extra headline where if description line one ended in a distinct sentence. So we're already shooting for those top three positions anyway. And the case is made that, you know, the sidebar ads, even though the click-through rate is going to be much lower, the conversion rate will tend to be similar to the top, if not better, because, you know, to your point, you have those searchers looking through the listings, and, you know, maybe, you know, they find that the third ad on the right, excuse me, is more relevant than the second ad on the top. So from the paid search side, you know, in conjunction with now the move to expanded text ads, we haven't seen too much of a decline. I think in most cases, not a decline at all. I think where it really hurts is sometimes these smaller businesses who don't have the budget always to bid as high. But even then, you know, it's never always been about he who spends the most gets the best listings. It's about, you know, certainly that's a factor, but it's also about making sure the you have good quality scores, you have relevance from search query to keyword trigger to ad shown to landing page. So it's definitely, you know, made a slight impact, I would say, but in the big scheme of things, I don't think it's been a big issue.
I would agree. I mean, we didn't have anyone that, it was too hard for us to to generate enough revenue from it to justify a retainer if we weren't in the top three before, and still it's the same. So I think you have to still play in those top positions to really get the ROI a lot of times.
Right. So the next question we have here is, towards the beginning of the presentation, we showed a slide on Search Console with organic versus paid. Where exactly is that in Search Console? So that report is actually in Google AdWords. You have to connect your Google Search Console account to Google AdWords. And then within Google AdWords, if you go to your Dimensions tab, it's a report. It's the paid versus organic report. And you have to view it at the account level. So you can't see it at individual campaigns. It just shows all the data at the account level. Another question for you, Garrett, and I think this is one we can, you know, we'll definitely both respond to, but we'll begin with you. How do you compare organic to paid results?
I compare it at the end of the funnel, frankly. If you can go end to end, that's amazing. If you can't, I would still just go into GA. And I would say Organic is great, but please do not misinterpret the fact that you don't pay for the click to mean that you don't pay for anything. Because I think they're a lot more similar than people want to admit, especially on the SEO side. I think that as an SEO, we can oftentimes sell SEO as like it's really amazing because you know your cost per acquisition is so much better. And I agree, I think that is true, but after you've sunk 8 months of content, link building, design, site speed, consulting hours into it, that yeah, it's a quote unquote free click. I would say the instantaneousness of PPC is appealing. I found for a lot of our clientele, they have got almost married to it, and they've actually really almost hurt their businesses because as competitors entered the landscape and the cost per clicks rose and it became more competitive, they did have a diminishing marginal returns in the sense that they weren't able to necessarily raise their price by the same amount that it was costing them to advertise for that lead. And so they were theoretically every day losing a bit of their margin on those leads. And so I think that is something to be really aware of. At the end of the day, what I would encourage you is if you're being very successful on a keyword for SEO, launch pay-per-click ads and vice versa. I think the key being that finding things that work in marketing is hard. And if you do find something, double down on it quickly because there is a lot of opportunity there. And I would say look at all the positions on organic. See if there's Capterra. See if there's software advice. See if there's, if you're a local business, see what local magazines are writing about you. If you search Orange County coffee shops, there's probably like six local magazines that have written on the top 10, top 8, top 15 coffee shops. Well, I would have every one of those editors in my coffee shop give them some free coffee, and I would build that relationship, and I would get them to write on me or include me in that list. I think the key here is just saying how many positions, how much market share, how much share of voice, how much share of search can I take for my most profitable queries? And then just understand the limitations of each channel. I wouldn't ever compare them one-to-one. I would simply consider them different marketing channels that have different objectives and different goals. And you need both to be really successful. You really do.
Yeah, I think that's really an amazing point about if you're finding something that's working, see where else you can take real estate. One of the, you know, kind of from the paid search side, we take that tactic when maybe we're seeing good results for a shopping PLA query, but that term isn't yet within our regular search text ad campaigns. So based upon what's working in shopping, we'll add to our search network text ad campaigns. So we show both that text ad and a PLA for the particular query to take up more of that space.
That's a great
next
point,
question we have here is, do you have any insight into why certain wording choices would work in an organic result and not work in a paid search result? We have some clients that have really high conversion rates for organic, so we tried duplicating the organic results in paid search, but we couldn't ever make the two channels have similar results. I can speak to that one first, Garrett. Some of the tactics we've been providing are really strategies of, you know, basing on where one item is working, where you can try it somewhere else and at least test it. You know, there are cases where it's not going to work the same way. And in this case, it seems like the attendee is saying that, you know, what's working organic and showing high conversion rate isn't doing in paid search. And there could be several variables for that. One is that maybe the listing that shows up in organic leads to a different landing page than where it's going in paid search. Maybe the specific organic queries are slightly different than what's showing in paid search. Those are just a couple of examples, but I think it's something where just constantly be testing between the two and kind of see what sticks, and then, you know, go from there.
Yeah, I think tagging on that, Matt, personas click differently. I would argue that there's a lot of different people searching that keyword, and there's different personas. And I think the reality is oftentimes you're more educated buyer who is doing a little bit more thorough work. Theoretically, right, they have to scroll. They might have to go through four ads, three map results, and multiple organic results to get you there, have seen a lot of other options and have done their research and determined you to be the best option from there. So oftentimes, those people are a far more marketing qualified lead for you, or e-commerce sales. So I think it's just a very different persona. Like for me, we rank in the top something for SEO services, but if I launch an SEO services ad, not only am I competing with people who sell SEO services for $400 a month, where now I don't align with my product offering with those people I'm competing against, number one. Number two, the people who click on those ads, theoretically, if you're looking for SEO services, you're going to go to the organic listings far more accurately because you know that those are ads, and you're wanting someone to help you with your organic. So I think oftentimes they're just different personas, and it could be the people advertising. There's a billion reasons, but I would say personas is the number one reason, if I had to just choose one logical reason why that's happening.
Yeah, no, certainly agree. Our next question comes from someone asking about an algorithm update. This person read that there was an unlisted Google algorithm update in March, which had an impact on many websites. Have you heard of this update? And if so, has it impacted your clients negatively or positively?
So, man, Google algorithm updates.
I know, kind of the thing we all dread.
The black box. So here's the reality. Google's updating their algorithm every day. They don't have to list them. So I think the reality is best practices are going to be far more powerful. And I don't actually worry about algorithm updates from like changing my tactics perspective. I use them to understand what they're currently servicing to make sure that I'm still the best answer for those questions. So if, for example, I just want to understand what they're weighing currently, like meaning that are there, like there was a great presentation, I was just at Share 16, and there was a great presentation on rich snippets. Well, rich snippets are pulling a lot, and people were afraid that, oh, Google's stealing my traffic. Well, you can actually, like there are trigger words, and there's things you can use in your HTML to pull these rich snippets, and you can take a lot of market share there. So I would be much more concerned, and I focus all my efforts on understanding what's going on at the SERP level. Like, how are people buying or like the products and or services that myself or my clients are offering? And then how do I do the best job of being the most delightful answer to their questions in every available opportunity? And so understanding Google algorithms is tough. Now, I think if you want to just have a surefire way of being very successful at SEO, I'll give it to you here. And it's going to be super basic, but it's actually what we do every day. And it's a lot more on consistency of execution than magical tactics. So make sure your site loads really, really fast. When I say really, really fast, if you can get it under 2 seconds, you're ahead of the competition, that's great. Make sure you're building links to relevant pages from relevant sites that your actual target market reads. Those are the best links in the world. So for example, when we publish on Moz and I can link back with the right anchor text to my PPC agency or SEO services page, that right there is a very valuable link. It not only sends valuable referral traffic, it not only builds our brand, but also helps us rank better. Then can you build incredible experiences, meaning that focusing less on old school traditional SEO metrics like lots of content and keyword density, and focusing more on, are you converting users? Are you giving them the information they want? Do you have viable things like case studies and samples and relevant content? And then are your keywords targeted correctly? And then lastly, can you improve the click-through rate of your titles? Because then once you rank in the top 10, you can theoretically increase and jump up in spots because within their data set, you're showing better click-through rates than similar sites in similar positions, and so they're going to keep bumping you up to see if you keep being a more viable answer to those people's questions. So I think the key here are those things.
Yeah, and you know, two kind of takeaways, two from there, is that there's never any magic bullet. I think people think that, you know, they can game the system, or you know, just if they follow along how the system works, you know, make the optimizations according to that and they'll be good. But you're right. I mean, it takes a lot of hard work, and it takes making sure that you have content that people are looking for, and that's going to be the most relevant. And you're right, there are certainly off-site or on-site items you can do. I especially agree with the fast load time. But, you know, that also draws into another issue of conversion rate optimization, which it has, you know, especially I've found over the last couple of years has become that much more important. And it's also being talked about not just in terms of, you know, tests, like, you know, for example, shortening a form or removing or changing a button. But, you know, stuff like page load time, the exact meta description someone may see when they look at your organic listings. It's all those factors now, and it kind of, you could almost say that this presentation we've done today, you could add a third component of it to CRO because it is that important.
Yeah, I completely agree. I mean, you make money off of, not off of Google's algorithm, you don't make money off of clicks. You know, you only make money when people theoretically either buy or fill out your form or contact you. And I think we focus so much more on getting people that oftentimes getting 100, even 10,000 more people isn't the same as just improving your conversion rate by 1%. And a great free tool for everyone out there if you want to do this is Hotjar. Hotjar is free. Just add one line of JavaScript. It's free for like 100 users, and you can pay like $10 a month. It's really, really affordable. You can record users. You can do funnel analysis. You can do form drop-offs. You can do polls. You can do questions. It's pretty much, honestly, the best tool out there for practically nothing. And from there, you can probably make more, far more money than doing anything else. It's just improving conversion rate.
Excellent. So Garrett, we have about 7 minutes left or so, and I want to ask one more question, and I'd like to get your side from, or your thoughts from the SEO side, and I'll share mine from the PPC side. But forecasting into 2017, since it'll be here before we know it, what are you seeing as the important SEO developments or areas that need to be concentrated on as we move into 2017?
Yeah, so I would say the most important thing going into 2017 is Google's whole focus right now, if we want to think about what Google's doing next and if you want to stay ahead of the curve, but their whole focus right now is going mobile. Everything's going mobile site speed, whether it's progressive web apps, whether it's AMP pages. Everything's going site speed, just like they had that big HTTPS push last year. They're going to be doing a massive push, I bet you, Q1, Q2, of 2017 for AMP pages. They're already pushing hard. They're going to be pushing even harder. Now, I'm not saying you have to go AMP, but I would say understand the logic of why they want you to go AMP was because they want load times under 1 second. And so if I were to do anything for SEO or PPC right now, I would be getting myself on a better server. I would buy myself a CDN. I would load all my scripts through GTM. And I would try to deload my clunky WordPress site if I could. Maybe get a custom CMS, run it more on HTML or more on JavaScript frameworks, and I would be focusing all of your SEO efforts on site speed until you get your site under 2 seconds, and then go back to other stuff. But if you want to say 2017, what's going to be the biggest? Site load speed. There's massive amounts of data that says, you know, if your site loads slow, every 1 second is a decrease of 7% in conversion rates in a big study done, and then over 53% of people won't wait for pages that load that take over 3 seconds to load. And then if you do have mobile sites, make sure you're using HTML5 in your forms. It'll start to pull the right keyboards so that people, if it says like phone number, it'll actually pull the numbers keyboard instead of non-numbers keyboard. So to actually check out, like go through your own checkout process on mobile. Go through your form fill out process on mobile. If it's not awesome and if it sucks, you are losing out probably 50% of your audience. And that's where you can make the most money, I think, right now. Do the best to generate new opportunities.
Yeah, that's certainly some powerful stuff. You know, just making sure that your site is easy to use and isn't going to waste people's times. From the PPC side, you know, what I would say is that kind of similar to the past 5 or 6 years or so, where you've been hearing a lot of the year of mobile. That's finally here. I think we can all agree that mobile at this point is, in many cases, you know, across many many search engine platforms, audience targeting platforms, is the majority now of audience. But I feel that as we move into 2017, audience targeting is going to get to that point where, you know, it truly is the year that audience targeting is going to be not necessarily more important than keyword targeting, but traditional PPC is going to be regarded as audience targeting. That's going to be a big portion of it now. You've seen it already with Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, LinkedIn, all of them advancing their social platforms, and Google and Bing both getting into audience targeting as well. Even more so, Google just started demographics for search ads. They've been doing a lot to update their display networks. So audience targeting is going to continue to be a core focus of paid or of PPC, and you know is really going to be one of the core components of it now, along with keyword targeting.
Completely agree, Matt. Completely agree. No doubt. No doubt at all.
Yeah, exciting times ahead. So Garrett, you know, I just wanted to thank you for participating in the webinar with us, and you know, for everyone who wants to get in touch with either Garrett or myself or the marketing teams, you can see the email addresses there. And Garrett, any final words from you?
Yeah, I mean, don't just email me for if you want a free search assessment. If you just have any questions, I mean, seriously, click on the link, shoot me an email. I'll try to get back to you within a day, and hopefully just be able to be a resource for you. We're trying to do a lot of great content right now. We're trying to be out there and help do a great job of just enlightening on a tactics-based approach that holds nothing back. Like, I don't have any secrets that you guys don't now know on these things. So, just feel free. And if you do need help, you know, please fill out our form. We'd love to help you out. So that's it from me. I'm just glad I got to be here. Thanks, Matt.
Yeah, and Garrett, thank you for participating in this webinar with us. It's always, you know, it's always great to kind of participate in other, you know, and see how other channels within the digital marketing atmosphere are working. Because I think overall, even though we have our specific focuses, it's so crucial to understand the overall landscape.
Yeah, totally agree.
So I want to thank you again for attending. Again, if you want to provide any feedback or ask any questions to either Hennepin Marketing, Directive Consulting, or Garrett himself, you can see those, or you can email those email addresses within the slide. So for Garrett Mergut, I'm Matt Umbro, and want to thank you again for attending our webinar, and it will be available shortly for you to view the recording. So thank you again, and everyone have a great afternoon.
Thanks, guys. Bye.